Welcome tonight as we gather to recognize what God has done, what God is doing, and what God continues to do in and around us and through us. Welcome. Long ago, Isaiah wrote, "Darkness shall cover the earth and thick darkness the peoples, but the Lord will arise among you and his glory will appear over you." When the Lord Jesus did appear, he said, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him." Tonight we ask the question, why? The answer is given to us by the gospel writer John, who said, "Because God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have eternal life." We gather in that hope and that promise made so long ago to Isaiah and spoken to him through Jesus and to us tonight. May God be with us. Please stand as we prepare for worship and greet those around you with hope as we prepare to worship and sing.
Though we come together this evening as a group of believers to reflect on the cross, it's as though each of us stands alone before the one who came to give his life. Each of us must respond to the thought of the old hymn, "When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died." What happens when you survey the cross? What happens when you reflect upon that cross and the person who was crucified there? Well, in 1630, Johann Hermann wrestled with the truth of the cross and wrote, "Who was the guilty? Who brought this upon you? It's my treason, Lord, that has undone you. 'Twas I, Lord Jesus, I it was denied you. I crucified you." It's a song that's very convicting because it reminds us that we were there when they crucified our Lord. As sinners, we were in on this. One of the verses of the song that we just sang also reflects that truth. But of all the volumes that have ever been written and all the hymns that have ever been sung, there are two words that give the clearest understanding of what it was that happened on a cross outside of Jerusalem over 2,000 years ago. And those are the words, "for us." For us. The Apostle Paul spoke of this in very clear terms when in the gospel or the letter to Romans in chapter 5, verse 8, we read, "God demonstrates his own love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." All that took place here on earth and in heaven, everything that happened on that cross and in the resurrection that followed was for us, for God's people. Now, we might not be able to fathom the profound depths of how it is that we are reconciled to God by placing our faith in this crucified one. We will more than likely never understand the various theories of atonement and how the cross of Christ relates to this amazing truth. Even so, we can survey the wondrous cross. We can reflect on the scene. We can take it in with our heart and soul and mind and hear a gentle spirit within whispering, "Jesus did this for me." Hermann came to the same conclusion. In the very next verse of that same song, he would say, "For me, dear Jesus, was your incarnation, your mortal sorrow and your life's oblation. Your death of anguish and your bitter passion was for my salvation." The result of the events of Good Friday are life-changing for those who embrace this amazing reality that the Son of God came to give his life for us. Something earth-shaking has taken place in the crucifixion of Jesus. We are understood and we are loved by God. I hope you see this, my friends. I hope you embrace that truth. Jesus Christ came to bring the healing, renewing, life-changing love of God to this world of hurting and spiritually hungry people like you and me. Now, incredibly and sadly, there were those who wanted nothing to do with this love of God incarnate and sent him to the city dump of Jerusalem where he was crucified. Nevertheless, he still loved them. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. He still loved them, and he loves us too, even though we too stand in that crowd that rejects his love and spurns his reaching out to us. God demonstrates his own love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And now, as we are told in Hebrews 4, verse 15, we don't have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, and yet without sin. In other words, no one understands you. No one understands you like the one who made you. And no one loves you more than the one who came to give his life for you, for us. And that is why we call this day, of all days, Good Friday. There's another song that's been just stuck in my head the past week as I thought about what to say to you folks this evening as God's spokesperson. It was written only a few years ago by Michael W. Smith, and it says basically the same thing as Romans 5, verse 8. I'd have us listen to the song, but we have plenty of our own Good Friday songs to hear and sing this evening. So let me conclude by just reciting some of the words to that song. If you know it, feel free to hum along. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you, in other words, you, the Son of God, were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind a stone, you lived to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all. You, O Lord, took the fall for us. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, help us through this service to remember your Son and our Savior, who, though rich, became poor and lived among us, who was mighty indeed, healing the sick and the troubled, who, as a teacher to his disciples, was their companion and servant. Help us, O Lord, through this time of worship to remember Jesus, who prayed for the forgiveness of those who rejected him and for the perfecting of those who received him, who loved all people and prayed for them, even if they denied and rejected him, who hated sin because he knew the cost of pride and selfishness, of cruelty and hatred, both towards people and towards God. Help us, O Lord, to remember Jesus. This evening and every day, Jesus, who humbled himself and was obedient to death, even death on a cross. And now, you have exalted him who has redeemed us from the bondage of sin and given us new freedom to serve you. May we ever be grateful for your Son, Jesus Christ, and for what he has done for us and continues to do for us. It's in his name that we offer up this prayer. Amen. while the choir is making their way up. Just want everyone to know that for Good Friday this year, we will be celebrating through the use of a tenebrae style service. During this service, we will walk with Jesus up until his death on the cross, using the gradual dimming of the lights, by the extinguishing of the candles up here on the stage. Most of the service now will proceed unannounced, with the exception of the walk-up communion. We will be led in worship now by the choir. There will be a few times in which the congregation is invited to sing along with the choir, and those words are in the bulletin and will be up on the screen at the appropriate time. After the last song has been sung by the choir this evening, all of us are invited to follow the Christ candle and the choir out of the sanctuary, and doing so in silence.
Into this place to survey the wondrous cross and to contemplate the events of Holy Week. Let us hear again the Holy Scripture and story of God's loving plan and purpose in the suffering of Christ to redeem us from sin and death. Holy Week started with the triumphal entry into Jerusalem with shouts of Hosanna, blessed is he comes in the name of the Lord. This was followed by Jesus teaching in the temple and being challenged by those in authority. He knew what lay before him, but Jesus faithfully followed his Father's will as the shadow of the cross weighed heavily on him. Let us pray that we may be transformed anew as we remember Christ's humiliation, and that we may be taught obedience as we remember Christ's obedience until death. May we love one another as Christ showed love for all people. May we also pray for those things God would have us ask in the name of Jesus as we pray as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Thank you. Jesus said,
I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.
Then came the day of unleavened bread, on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John, saying,
Go and make preparations for us to eat the Passover.
Where do you want us to prepare it? They asked. He replied,
As you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to the house that he enters, and say to the owner of the house, The teacher asks, Where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large room upstairs, all furnished. Make preparations there.
They left and found things just as Jesus had told them, so they prepared the Passover. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them,
I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer, for I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God.
Do this in remembrance.
And Jesus took bread, and he gave thanks and broke it. And then he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is my new covenant with you in blood, which is poured out for you." At this time, I invite the elders to come forward. An elder will dismiss each row to go down either side of the aisle, in the side aisles. And once you have taken communion up at the front, then please go back down the center aisle back to your seat. If you prefer to receive communion where you are seated, an elder will be available to serve you. If you wish to receive prayer as you're coming up here, Cole Plegan-Cool and myself will be at the center aisle to pray for you and or for your children. Let us partake of the Lord's Supper.
In Christ alone, hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of
thank you. To the Father's will,
My debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me, and the sun sets free. Precious in His holy sight. justice has been satisfied. We will all be fast.
Take our communion offering. The deacons can come forward and receive that.
after the meal with his disciples in the upper room, Jesus walked with his disciples. He said,
"You will all desert me this very night. So it is written by the prophet Zechariah, 'Strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.'"
Peter told him, "Even if everyone falls away because of you, I will never fall away."
"Truly I tell you,"
Jesus said to him,
"tonight, before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times."
"Even if I have to die with you," Peter told him, "I will never deny you." And all the disciples said the same thing. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he told the disciples, While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief of priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them: "The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him." Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus replied,
"Do what you came for, friend."
Then the men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested him. G Jesus knew the charges placed against him were false, but he continued to willingly walk the path he was called to walk, knowing the cross was nearer than ever before. Jesus was taken to Caiaphas, the high priest, and after questions and charges of blasphemy, he was deemed worthy of death. Then his accusers spit in his face and struck him with their fists. Next, Jesus was taken before the governor, Pilate, who asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?"
"You have said so,"
Jesus replied. Now it was the governor's custom at the festival to release a prisoner chosen by the crowd. At that time, they had a well-known prisoner whose name was Barabbas. So when the crowd had gathered, Pilate asked them,
thank you.
Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rocks split, and the tombs broke open. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God."